In March 2014, in preparation for this series, I began writing to a young woman in Florida. A woman called Emilia Carr. Emilia is the same age as I am, but our lives couldn't be more different. Emilia Carr spends 23 hours a day locked up in a prison cell. The youngest woman living on America's death row. There are just over 200,000 women in prison in the US, 58 of them facing a sentence of death. And 37% of correction officers working in the US penal system are women, some of them running the toughest prison regimes in the country.
You want to freaking pay dollar for attention to freaking dollar for detail? Do I understand? Do you understand me?
With gun culture rampant.
If somebody's coming at you and they're a threat, do you not want to kill them?
No.
And gang culture vicious as ever.
It's really no way that you can just walk away from it. It's blood in, blood out. But in my case, I
what
feel
do you
like
mean, blood in, blood out? What does that mean?
You fight to get in and you die to get out.
Oh. I was going to America hoping to meet the youngest woman on death row. And to get some handle on a society that drives its women to be super tough, but uses the most brutal strong arm tactics when they step out of line and into the wild zone. And 15 minutes to wake-up call at Miami-Dade Prison Bootcamp, Florida. The notorious bootcamp system allows younger offenders to trade long sentences for the short, sharp shock of a hellish six-month regime. But Miami-Dade Bootcamp is different. This one's run almost entirely by women. The barrack was full of convicted felons, most in for armed robbery, some for attempted murder. But these two female drill sergeants were terrifyingly in control. Even a flicker of insubordination brought swift punishment.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
AM, the daily pre-breakfast boot camp workout. And here's where I was joining the prison population for real.
Hurry up! 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, and 1! It's dumb and done! Dumb and done! Dumb and done!
Up close, it was hard to take this shtick seriously. It was just a full mental racket in my ears. But then something clicked inside me, and I started to feel genuinely intimidated.
Aye, ma'am. Don't freaking hop on me! You don't freaking talk on Sarah! Don't hop on freaking talk on Judas, so you understand me?
Aye, ma'am.
I'd met tough women in my life, but these ladies were in a league of their own.
Hey, you don't freaking talk on fool by body, you freaking talk on round! You don't freaking talk on creep and freaking bigger and freaking in front of you! Aye, ma'am.
Well, your grip is just like this. Put your last little thumb, just like this, curl it down.
Fix your freaking doggone eyes on this freaking doggone book. You understand me?
Aye, ma'am.
Hey! Oh, ma'am! Oh, ma'am! Ma'am or mess!
Without any breakfast in the baking pre-dawn Florida heat, the young criminals were being barked into submission.
Arms downward! Boom!
He said swish!
Take it!
There was definitely no malingering in the face of these four 10 bitch nados.
She need to freaking open up her sock!
Open up her sock! I can't count for you!
Four.
Five.
Six. Louder!
Eight. You speak out, not you.
Nine.
1, 2, 3,
ho!
Ho!
Hurry
up!
At the Miami-Dade Prison Bootcamp, this was the morning routine, 7 days a week. They also accept women prisoners onto the boot camp program. But today there was only me. The intense heat was really getting to me, so I raised my hand to wipe the sweat out of my eyes. Bad move.
Get your grip from the back of your back!
Are you having fun? Yes or no?
No, ma'am.
I don't hear you. Yes or no?
A hand raise was an act of aggression, and an act of aggression spelt a lap of the track. With a Florida felon sent in hot pursuit, I felt like a rabbit being chased by a pit bull. And then I realized that if I really was the only girl in boot camp, these tough women would be cutting me no sisterly slack.
I'm not free, Macy! I said I'm not free, Macy! Hurry up!
Time, I'm done!
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
It was back in for breakfast, and I was dying to know if these women were as tough as they seemed.
You have to be tough on them, because out here in these streets, it's tough. These streets are not gonna slow down for you. Even though it's tedious and it's tough and it's hard, they appreciate it, because we're not giving up on them. I'm not gonna allow them to give up on themselves. So that's me. I'm not gonna give up on you, so if I'm not giving up on you, you're not giving up on yourself. So you see how I kind of build them up and try to raise their self-esteem and let you know, but you're still trash.
That's it. Keep your head out straight forward. Don't look around.
Breakfast was one grip, which meant the whole mess of dog food grade bologna had to be eaten with just one hand. Food here was to be endured, not enjoyed.
One grip. Everybody have one grip.
They'll figure it out, because the time will be up by the time she's freaking done.
Like, they're coming in as attempted murderers, whatever they've done. Is it not intimidating to try and deal with them as a woman? Like, do you not think that they respect you less?
The women that we have here are pretty tough, and we don't give in, we don't let up, and you know, we piggyback off our male instructors.
I think the male drill instructors have a harder time than we do, because I think these guys, you know, they almost look at us as parent figures, as mothers.
As females, though, we got some pretty tough women here.
I didn't notice.
Yeah.
Whatever you dreamed about last night, you thought you was gonna eat.
That's exactly what it is.
That's some good pancakes, homemade. Gotta eat, because there ain't nothing else after this until...
Until what, 4 o'clock,
until,
5 o'clock?
4 or 5, so ain't no snack in between. It ain't no extra apple, nothing.
I think that is bologna.
Steak meat!
Steak meat. But I don't know what that is. I don't know what
that
is.
That's how you like it. Grits.
Whatever that is. Look, butter. Apple.
With apple, that. Milk.
Apple so good.
Yeah, but that was good for you.
Anything they do is basically they have to get permission.
Do they have any time though to do just chill?
Quiet time.
Because a lot of our cadets are illiterate.
Really?
Yes.
All right,
literate or not, after breakfast the prisoners are marched into class. And here at last was my opportunity to get some insight into how these guys got here and how they were coping with it all.
What did you do to find yourself getting here?
I made mistakes. I got caught up with a strong arm robbery charge last year, and I didn't actually do it, but you know, they came and convicted me, and I have 2 grand theft auto charges, and I have 2 co-defendants in here with me. But when my player defender, she told me about boot camp, I jumped on it. I said, yeah, I'll take boot camp.
If you hadn't come to boot camp, how long would you have gotten in big prison?
Man, the lowest they were trying to give me was 10 years, but the max, it was 25, man.
Oh my God, so 6 months here, even though it's tough, it's worth it.
Ma'am, yes, ma'am.
And you don't feel like that you would leave here and fall back into your old ways?
Ma'am, no, ma'am, man. Ma'am, no, ma'am.
I can't wait to get back home.
You know, boot camp is just a big wake-up call. Like, that first day we all came in here, it was a big slap in the face. Like, hey, you gotta change your life. It's time to, like, to grow up.
Man, damn, there's 20-something plus in here, and I'm a whole lot out of you. Tell me what keeps going down.
Were you surprised to see so many female officers?
Ma'am, yes, ma'am, man.
Who are you more frightened of, though? Because I'm a bit more frightened of the females.
Ma'am. Jenna shut their officer Pierre Lewis, man.
He's the scariest, is he?
No, man, it's a she, man.
Oh, she is. Oh, well, she's the scariest.
Ma'am, yes, ma'am.
Ready? Prompt. Ready? Eight.
Outside in the drill yard, I went looking for corrections officer Pierre Louis. The scariest woman in the Miami-Dade boot camp.
I don't know why, I just assumed the men would have been scarier than the women, but they said that you were the most frightening. So what do you think about that?
Well, I don't know. I don't know about being the scariest. I know I take my job serious, so I like what I do.
The yelling and the screaming, that's the bit that sort of got me. Like, I didn't mind the exercise or anything, but it's just like constantly being shouted at if you do it wrong. It's tough. Well, it's tough for me. I'm not used to having somebody shout at me.
Well, that's the thing. These guys, you gotta understand, they've probably never had anybody yell and scream at them. Some of them have no discipline.
You better freaking pay dog attention to freaking dog on detail. Do I understand? Do you understand me?
We break them up to build them back up. When they first came, you know, they had an attitude. They don't want to talk to you. You know, they all that. They rule the world.
Yeah.
So that is part of the breaking down, teaching them the discipline, teaching them the respect that they need to have when they're out there in the society,
yeah,
in the real world.
It's a crazy job to have, but there's so many women in there.
Yeah, but you gotta love what you do. That's probably why they say I'm the meanest.
Women love shouting, that's probably
why.
Yeah. Quick me!
And then, you know, as a woman, men don't tend to respect you. So,
yeah.
You know, you have to put on that, okay, I'm not here to play. Want to go home in 6 months? I'm gonna help you get there.
Yeah.
You know, so that's why.
Mid-morning and a break from the grind with a weekly visit to the prison book unit and a dressing down from boot camp big boss Lieutenant Green.
It's ridiculous, but we keep going through the motions. You get out of it what you put into it. It's simple.
I know.
If you don't grow up, I make you grow up.
You ready?
Yeah.
Okay.
Ma'am,
good morning, ma'am.
Good morning, ma'am.
See, it's saying good morning, but the cadets with the lazy tongue keep saying ma'am, morning, ma'am. It is ma'am, good morning, ma'am. Ma'am, good afternoon, ma'am. Ma'am, good evening, ma'am. Or sir, good evening, sir. Not sir, evening, sir. But see, regular folk, you don't have to keep correcting. People that are trying, you don't have to keep correcting. People that's going through the motions, you have to correct.
Good morning, ma'am.
Okay, let's go here.
What did they do at the top? Why did you start?
Well, this week we had a lot of chaos, up and down. I ended up shipping several people for just acting out disciplinary reason. And that's unusual for this week, for us, to have so many. So I'm stressing to them that they need to get it right.
These are what I call fake gangsters. Yeah. Fake gangsters, because they think they're big, tough guys. And then when really they go with some grown men, boom, boom. Yeah.
Everywhere I looked, these fake gangsters seem to be in real trouble.
Hey. What did they do? What did they do that you brought them in?
He just arrived back. He's from my platoon, my old cadets. So because he comes back, he
goes. 15, 14, 13, 12, 11.
That was interesting because the last guy who was outside getting in trouble, he actually owes the officer because it's his second time coming to boot camp. So now pretty much I think that officer makes his life sort of hell because he's come back again.
Kano, what the frick you doggone doing? What is that, Kano?
My absolute new favorite phrase that I'm bringing back to Ireland is, what the freak you goddamn do? What was that you said there? What the freak you dog down do? What was that? Well, it wasn't because I want to take that back to Ireland. It's amazing.
It's just, what the freak you doing? You know, instead of, you know, we don't swear at the cadet.
So freak dog down do.
Yeah.
What the freak you dog down do?
Yeah, that's our boot camp jargon.
What did he do?
He wasn't pivoting, and he's acting like he don't want a freaking dog on Mars. So that's why we asked him what the freak he dog gonna do.
You gave him a fair screech as well.
So how are you enjoying it so far?
Good, it's amazing. We just saw a guy who came back in, and it's supposedly his second time around.
Yes.
So would he went out, he re-offended. How would he get another chance here?
Well, re-offended on the outside, or he got kicked out of boot camp and he was allowed to come back? It depends.
Oh, so he could have gone to prison for like 6 months and then been allowed to come back?
Yes, the judge probably would have let him come back for a second time.
And would you guys make it a little bit tougher for him now because it's the second time?
Oh, yes, when you're recycled, you should know that trash. It was the cause and effect.
20-year-old Sebastian is one of the boot camp's most persistent recycles.
This is the fourth time I've been to a boot camp. I've actually been to the military before.
Okay.
And I've been to two juvenile boot camps before this. But so whenever it first came up, honestly, I was like, look, I've done this so many times. I'm tired of it, and it's not gonna change me, yeah. But getting, like, I didn't really have a choice. It was this or prison.
Prison for 10 plus years.
No, 25.
25 years.
Yes.
But does that not frighten you if you're thinking about, like, you're 20 years old, you're a baby,
right?
To me.
Okay.
Like, to think about spending 25 years of your life in prison.
Yeah, no.
Stealing
I don't want to spend.
Car, and it's probably a crap car too. Sorry, I was gonna say that.
No, ma'am. No, ma'am. I've done a lot more than steal cars, ma'am. So I can't judge anybody.
I don't think you should tell anyone that if you got away with it so far.
What age
did you first go to boot camp, though?
I first went to boot camp when I was 13 years old, ma'am. And then 16, and then basic training when I was 17, and then this.
Would you like to go back into the Army or no?
I'm actually working on that right now, ma'am.
Oh, that's what you're gonna do?
Possibly.
So you love boot camp then?
Yeah. Now the physical part is nothing, it's really the mental part.
While these guys were in the first 4 months of the program, an upstairs wing houses prisoners in their final 2 months. And they get to leave every day on work release. Although not all of them had jobs to go to yet.
Why is he cleaning in there? Because it's just clean up time. It's clean up time. We're constantly cleaning. You want to speak to him?
Yeah, sure.
Come here, cadet. Why are you cleaning the head?
I got my job with female.
Speak.
This cadet was told between the head by a judge that the officer can't tell you, man.
You have a job lined up?
Yes, ma'am.
Where?
At a restaurant, man.
Which one? The Chuck Wagon?
Man, no, man.
Which one?
There's a French restaurant called Le Boche, the Grove, man.
This in the Grove?
Went to an interview yesterday, man, got the job, man. This cadet just waiting for them to give me the schedule to go in, man.
Okay. Carry on.
All right, ma'am. I got out of my side, sir.
So they're getting employed?
Yeah.
Officer Marin?
Ma'am?
How many people have employment?
Five.
Okay.
But we have like about 10 on interviews.
Okay.
So it's good.
Although most of the cadets end up on work release in their last 2 months, some were heading towards rehab.
What did you do? Do you mind me asking?
What happened?
What did you do to get in trouble?
Well, actually, I started off with drugs. I got the habit from my sisters. Every time I get money, I want to spend it on drugs. And eventually, I came back with an old friend, and we robbed two old people for their car. And then I went to court. I actually begged my attorney for opportunity. She asked my judge to. My judge didn't want it to give it to me. She was gonna actually give me 28 years in prison. So she told me that if I mess up this opportunity, that's just it.
How did you come off drugs? Did they send you to rehab?
No. Now I'm actually thinking to ask the lieutenant or the counselor to see if they can actually put me in a drug program for the last 2 months that I got for work release.
Not all of the women who work at Miami-Dade are wreck the head tough girls. In a tiny office out the back, I found the prison's least shouty woman.
I've learned a lot about drugs since working here, so.
Yeah.
One of the drugs that I know is common amongst them is a drug called bars or Xanax, where they crush up Xanax pills and they snort them. That's a sleeping pill or some kind of pill, I'm not sure. And
Xanax, yeah, I know, yeah, Xanax, yeah. Yeah.
And I know they do a lot of harem.
Really?
Yes.
I wouldn't have thought it would have been that.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and I'm always shocked. After, when they're here for the first 7 to 10 days, I complete an assessment on them. Just me and them one-on-one. I tell them, you don't have to be afraid to tell me the truth because I can't rearrest you for whatever you tell me. Just let me know what's going on with you so I can help you.
Yeah.
And they're normally very candid about what's going on and what they've done prior to coming into this facility. And I'll say about 90% have done drugs.
Ground transfer now.
It was hard to believe these clean-cut, disciplined boy bots were ever junkies. And I wondered, when these tough, loving women stopped ruling their lives, would they have a hope in hell of keeping straight?
I still can't help but, like, feel sympathy for them just because they're so young compared to me. And I just feel sorry for them. I can't help it. I know I shouldn't. Do you ever feel a little bit sorry for them?
No.
The little cute 16-year-old, not even a little bit?
No.
I do.
No, not even. The only thing I feel for them is maybe hope.
Yeah.
For, you see a little 16-year-old, I see who they could be.
Yeah.
Who they could be when they finish. The man that they could be.
The thing that really got to me about boot camp wasn't the toughness of the staff. It was the toughness of the sentences these young prisoners were originally facing. So I went to meet a local judge to ask why.
There's these 16-year-old boys and they've robbed a car, made a mistake, and there's a possibility they're going to jail for 25 years.
Yes.
That is so wrong. I think it's like stealing someone's whole life away from them.
So several years ago, there was a rash of juvenile crime, mm-hmm. which the press called juvenile predators, super predators, if you will. So the legislature, in reaction to that, passed a whole series of laws that made certain felonies, like stealing a car, an offense where the state attorney could make a determination to what we call direct file kids to the adult court. That's a reaction to that kind of law and order mentality of some of our legislators and the cry from the public that we needed to do something about these quote unquote juvenile super predators.
Yeah, it's really mean, I think. To me, that seems like such a waste of money to send somebody to jail for 25 years. But you wouldn't get 25 years in Ireland for murder. Like, I could be out in less than 10 years if I killed you.
Oh, well, hopefully that won't happen.
Next day, I had a day off in Miami, which was great, but I was worried. I still hadn't received confirmation from federal prison authorities that my request for an interview with death row inmate Emilia Carr had been granted. Death row is the end of the line for America's tough girls. But I was going to visit a cafe in California which throws a lifeline to female gang members before they too might face the ultimate wrath of the American penal system. And in a country that enshrines the right to carry arms, I was going to discover the passionate relationship between an American tough girl
right, so
and her
you
gun.
You're on fire now.
Here we go.
There are 58 women currently on death row in the US. And I've come here with a plan to interview death row's youngest female prisoner. 30-year-old Emilia Carr, who was convicted of murdering her boyfriend's wife when she was just 25. At the Miami-Dade Prison Bootcamp, I'd already had a glimpse of how tough the American penal system could be.
Don't freaking eyeball me! You don't freaking dog on me! Don't freaking dog on Judas, do you understand me?
But I'd heard of a brilliant place in LA called the Homegirl Cafe, helping women caught up in the city's vicious neighborhood gang culture to learn catering skills and reroute their lives away from a terrible cycle of prison and drugs.
Can everyone bow their heads? Lord, we come to you with humble hearts and open minds and ask that you just have your way in our life and in our hearts. I ask that you guide the ones who are struggling, guide our children, bless them, and just keep them safe.
I'm in the process of getting my gang-related tattoos moved. This is my fourth session. This is what it looked like being my fourth session.
So what does that 40, what does that have to do with a gang?
It was the neighborhood that I was once upon a time representing.
You're like basically fighting with other people who
don't come from where I come from, I guess.
That's it, just people, if they didn't come from where you came from, you just...
Or they don't represent the same color that I represented.
What color do you represent? Did you?
Well, blue. It was blue.
Is that the blues or the Crips? The Crips
and
the...
Yeah, the reds or the bloods.
Yeah.
I grew up in South Central. I was born and raised into the gang life. Yeah. Some people choose to gangbang because lack of love and...
Is that why you went into the gangs?
They didn't have a family. I was, like he said, a follower. My sister, my brothers, family members were gang members, and I just felt like I was the odd one.
If you weren't.
So, right. So, that's how I became a part of that.
Are they still in the gangs, your brothers and sisters?
Yeah. 2005, I was arrested for carjacking and armed robbery. And I was looking at 48 years to life plus 10 years for gang enhancement, so that would have been 58 years to life. I think it's only by the grace of God that I was spared because...
So you didn't do any time first?
No, I did time. I did time. I did 3 years.
3 years,
and
yeah.
It was because they dropped the kidnap in both counts. They dropped both counts of armed robbery and one count of carjacking, so I served the lowest term for one carjacking. 2011, I moved to Las Vegas in hopes of maybe changing the environment, not only for myself, but for my children. And maybe, I was thinking that maybe that would change my whole mind frame. When I got out there, I couldn't find a job. So I started back selling drugs. And with that, I was indicted in 2013, and I served 2 years in a federal detention center. During that time is when it became an eye-opener for me that this is it for me. This is no longer the lifestyle that I want to live in. For the first time in my life, I can say I'm doing everything right. I'm not doing nothing on the side, no game banging, no hustling,
yeah.
Using drugs or nothing like that. I'm just on the straight and narrow.
So when you leave a gang, how do you just leave? Do they not go mad?
It's really no way that you can just walk away from it. It's blood in, blood out. But in my case, I
feel
like...
What do you mean blood in, blood out? What does that mean?
You fight to get in and you die to get out.
Oh.
I've gotten... People tell me they're gonna do this and they're gonna do that, but where I'm at right now, that's not my concern. My concern is staying focused on Kendra and getting me together and doing what I have to do for my children and make sure they don't take the same path that I did.
I've seen documentaries on the Crips and Bloods.
Yeah.
It's pretty wild.
Yeah, it is.
But it's just...
As well as learning new skills, at home girl, ex-member Kendra was being given the chance to get rid of her Crips gang tattoos.
Oh, tattoo removal.
Which mark her out as trouble to employers and the police.
So what tattoos? You're getting rid of these two?
These tattoos on my back.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
How many sessions have you had?
Four so far.
I mean, this is all homemade ink, and the homemade ink that I...
How do they do that in prison, though?
Indian ink, copy ink. I have a tattoo right here they did on me in prison, and it's both of my kids' name.
Yeah.
But I got it redone over outside, but as you can see, it scarred me.
Yeah.
Right there, and it was used with the ink that you use at the copy machine.
When I think of prison, I just think of all the really horrible, horrible things that go on, and maybe it's not like that. Maybe it comes sort of like a community, but like, I don't really know. Is it violent all the time? Are people getting raped all the time?
For women, it's different politics. Whereas in a men prison, they politic. In a women prison, just don't bother nobody's girlfriend and don't owe nobody no money, and you'll be fine.
In the tattoo removal clinic, local laser technicians volunteered to help the ex-gang members to burn away their violent past.
That's my foul.
It's you?
Y'all ain't shit.
Let's do it.
It's me. You're supposed to be on my side.
So this, and then this, and this. What's the little top bit mean?
It's like my rival. It's like how you diss them.
Do you have to beat somebody up?
You ready?
Yes.
The laser is breaking up the ink of the tattoo like a hammer on a rock.
Yeah. You can actually see it hitting her skin, though.
Well, there are inks, too, that are exquisitely sensitive to the laser.
Does it burn her skin, though?
Yeah.
Oh, wait. Oh, it's ready.
I'll show you. I'm not...
Just one time.
One time, honey.
You ready?
No. I didn't feel anything.
So you don't unless you have ink.
I was getting such a fright there.
Okay.
How many more sessions? Is that how long a session lasts? That's it?
Yeah.
It's quick.
Mm-hmm.
Not on your face, though.
Oh, my God. I just wear MAC.
Yours would be easy to cover up, though, that one.
Yeah. And when I wear my hair down, my bangs cover it, so I'm good. Put a little MAC on, and I'm fine. Oh, my goodness.
Is it really painful?
Hell yeah.
You did good with that, though. You didn't whinge.
Ooh.
I couldn't help thinking that the US is a tough place for a woman to survive when she's poor and, let's face it, not white. But while the gang girls deal in drugs and handle illegal weapons, their more privileged sisters go shopping for their guns legally in massive firepower superstores.
Like a Nissan Micra? Hi!
Hi, you must be Vogue.
I am, how are you?
I am Debbie, nice to meet you.
Debbie. You've got such a small car.
It's a US thing. We like big trucks around here.
Let's go.
All right, let's go.
Let's go shooting.
Let's go shooting. All of the walls are littered with firearms.
God.
Shotguns, rifles, every
what
kind of.
What is that?
That one is a UTS-15, it says, so it's a 12-gauge shotgun.
Okay.
Shotguns, all kinds of really cool things.
This is crazy that you have a shop like this.
These are pretty cool right here in the middle. PS-90 is what Secret Service actually carries, is concealed.
How could you conceal that? It's huge.
They do under long jackets. Oh. Looks a little scary, but.
Do you own one of them?
I do. In my personal collection.
So how did you get into guns? It's such a... Well, maybe it's not strange over here.
It's not strange here. My husband and I have been married 31 years, and actually I didn't like guns for very, very many years until about 5 years ago.
And what changed 5 years ago?
The economy, where things are going, where the U.S. is headed, where the world is headed for that matter, changed my mind that I really need to protect it. I'm a realtor as well on the other side, and you meet people that you just don't know. You know, are they good people? Are they bad people? Do they have good intents, bad intents? You don't really know.
What is your gun club?
My gun club is the girl in the gun shooting. Yeah. You see it here on my shirt.
Yeah.
And what we are is lady instructors for ladies only. So no male involvement, just ladies.
Look at that leopard print gun. I just put in my birthday order and I have a leopard print Louboutins ready to go. I just find it so weird that you, like, hundreds of guns just up on the walls right here.
But it's like
at the back of Gun World was a shooting range where I was kind of reluctantly letting Debbie give me my first lesson in gunslinging. Not surprisingly, the place was full of men, and not the kind of men you'd want to meet down a dark alley at midnight.
Oh. What was that?
That is a rifle being shot.
That would blow your entire face off.
Yes.
What do you ever need that for?
Home protection. For birds.
Does anyone ever get shot in the range?
It does happen on occasion. But I don't think that we've had this range specific. And those are really rare places.
That doesn't make me feel any better.
It's very rare that happens.
Yeah.
This is a 9mm.
That could definitely kill somebody.
Yes. You're in a defensive situation. So if somebody's coming at you and they're a threat, would you not want to kill them?
No.
Would you want to hurt them? Okay, well, there's ways to do that. But remember, if you're doing self-defense, your mindset is already saying that you're prepared to kill somebody. If you're carrying firearms for defense, you're prepared.
But like any old looper could get a gun.
Well, not anybody can get a gun. Felons can't get them. You know, now, with that being said, you can have a license, whatever, to get them. But do illegals do things all the time without getting licenses? Sure, there's a black market
for
that.
Could I walk out of here with a gun?
No.
Okay.
Because it's a 5-day waiting period. And because you're not from the U.S., you wouldn't be able to get it anyways at that point. All right, so I'm going to give you this one. Nice, high, and tight, okay? Make sure that thumb stays on that side.
Yeah.
Excellent. Okay, you're on fire now.
Yeah.
So, there you go.
Can I shoot it?
Absolutely.
Firing a gun felt easy, much too easy. How soon before it just felt normal?
I want to get the purple.
Okay. All right, to the other side we go.
Debbie was keen to take me to the next level of firepower, but I wasn't feeling one bit comfortable here.
I know that you really love guns and everything like that, and that's fine, that's what you like to do, but I just don't agree with the American gun culture. I just think it's wrong, and I don't think everyone should have the right to own a firearm, because it's pretty obvious why. There's so many killings.
Well, there's other ways. I mean, there's knives, and there's always a way, no matter what country you live in. Believe me, there's still a way that there's firearms and people get them illegally.
When I see people walking along the street here, like the police with guns and everything, it makes me feel a bit uneasy. And even being in there with that guy with the shotgun, I cannot understand why he needs to have that.
You hear about rapes, you hear about murders, you hear about people getting hurt.
Yeah.
Just because I'm in a safe community, I'm in a safe home, my husband knows how to shoot, what's gonna happen if it's me? What stops the idiot from down the street coming over? And he's got a mission on his mind, her mind, rape, murder. What do I do then? So I said, I have to be able to protect myself and my family, because what if that would happen to me? I don't just carry a firearm.
Yeah.
Usually I have pepper spray, I have a taser, I have knives.
I just think we're safer without them.
So that just means when I come to Ireland, I can't bring my gun.
No gun.
So then I'm gonna find you so that you can protect me.
I don't even think you can bring your pepper spray to Ireland.
I don't think so.
No.
We've checked, actually. I don't think you can bring it. I don't think I can even bring my knife there.
Not a taser, nothing.
Sunday.
This was the news I'd been waiting for, with a mix of anticipation and dread.
It's such a strange feeling to think that I'm going to be going to meet Emilia Carr on death row.
I was off to Ocala in central Florida, home to the Lowell County Women's Correctional Facility, where five women currently await their fate on death row. One of them was 30-year-old Emilia Carr, and I was finally going to meet her.
So it's kind of like you're in this shock, because you're just like, that didn't happen. That didn't happen. That didn't happen.
Ocala, Florida is 79 miles from Disneyland. It's home to megastar actor John Travolta and the location of the state of Florida's female death row. 30-year-old Emilia Carr was sentenced to die here 5 years ago for her part in the kidnap and murder by suffocation of her boyfriend's wife, Heather Strong. While Emilia received the death sentence, her boyfriend got life for the same crime. Now that I was finally here, I felt like a fraud. How was I, with my free and charmed life, going to look into this condemned young woman's eyes, knowing that there was nothing I could really do to help her?
That day in court that you got convicted, what did the judge actually say to you?
He read the sentence and then he said, "May God have mercy on your soul." And I actually had something written down that I read afterwards about the entire thing, but it's more like shock.
Yeah.
Like it doesn't really sink in, because my mom was there and my little sister and my best friend at the time. And, you know, I'm sitting there thinking, because I had already prepared myself, because I mean, everybody was talking about it. You know, they'd never had a case like this. I mean, I was convicted before I went to trial in the media. You know, in the local papers and stuff. I was already convicted. So I had already had my mindset that either way, I knew I was going to prison. it was just my family I was concerned for. So when he read the sentence, and my mom just collapsed. I knew I couldn't cry. I had to be strong. Yes, my mom. So, you know, I turned around and I was like, it's okay, it's not over. We're gonna fight this. It's okay, it's okay. So it's like you get back, and because I'm from here, I grew up with a lot of people that worked at the county jail and stuff, and you can see them crying, and that's when it hit me.
Yeah.
So it's kind of like you're in this shock, because you're just like, that didn't happen. That didn't happen, that didn't happen.
And how long did it take before it really kicked in?
I want to say probably a few days after I got here. A few days after I got here, and I actually went through a stage when I first got here where I was really stressed out, and just my hair was falling out by the handfuls. I mean, because it was hitting me, and it's like, wow. So
do you think that you did go through a slight depression then when you got
when
in
I
here?
First got here, I even had medical issues for a couple months because I was just really stressed out.
And did you think when you first got in here and you were like, the judge told you that you were sentenced to be executed, did you think for the first while, this is gonna happen to me, I'm gonna be killed?
No.
You never ever thought that?
No, honestly, no. Because that's the thing is, I've studied. When I first got here, I really started to study the death penalty and Florida and how it works, because I have to fight. Nobody ever speaks out, nobody fights, nobody does anything, because there's this fear that the attorneys put in you, the court-appointed attorneys, that if you speak out, it's gonna be used against you.
How long have you actually been on death row for?
Almost 5 years now.
5 years. Right. And you sort of get to a point where you get used to your life. No, you never do.
I don't. Some people adjust, I don't.
You don't at all?
No, because when you get comfortable here, you stop fighting.
Yeah.
It becomes, you just accept it, and you can't accept it.
Yeah. Do you ever think that you will actually be executed?
Mm-mm. I don't believe that.
You don't think it's ever gonna happen?
The United States Supreme Court, you fucking, I'm telling you, man, you motherfuckers keep fucking with my goddamn execution, there's gonna be bloodshed.
The last woman to be executed in the state of Florida was serial murderer Aileen Wuornos, subject of the Charlize Theron film Monster, who died here by lethal injection back in 1992. In 2000, lethal injection became the standard method of execution in Florida, though the electric chair is still used, but only if the inmate requested and was convicted in 1999 or earlier.
Are you on your own 23 hours a day?
24.
And do you ever get to go outside? Do you ever get to exercise?
We go outside 3 days a week for 2 hours on each day. So we only go outside 6 hours a week.
And what do you do when you go outside?
When we go outside, we're kind of like in a bigger cage, and we'll laugh, we'll listen to music, we'll play basketball.
We grew up probably listening to the same bands, NSYNC, Backstreet Boys. Did you like them?
Yeah, at one point in time.
What did you want to do before all this happened? You're in your 30s now. Did you ever think you'd find yourself on death row in your 30s?
No, I actually wanted to work here at one time.
Really?
Yeah.
What did you want to do here?
I wanted to be a corrections officer.
Why? And is that what you always wanted to be since you were younger?
I actually originally wanted to go into the military, and then I wanted to study photography. Then I wanted to get into law enforcement. And then I became a massage therapist.
And was that your job before mm-hmm. you came in here? You found yourself living on death row, but do you think that it's more of a living death?
It's your mindset, because, like, for me, I've taken advantage of it. I've learned who I am. I'm going through school. I'm educating myself. I've discovered things about me I didn't know. And I'm a better person because of it. There are people who just get into this depression and they just waste years and years and years just sitting there moaning and groaning because they have that mindset. But I've learned to laugh in the face of impossibility. Where man says no, I mean, I laugh because I don't believe that.
And so the loneliness doesn't get you or anything like that?
Not really.
Are there any inmates here that you would say would be your good friends that you can talk to on death row?
There's a couple of us up there that we laugh and giggle a lot.
So do you just sort of talk to each other through your cells?
Through the doors, yeah.
Do you not really miss, like, getting to hug somebody or just any sort of human contact?
I miss that a lot.
And how often can your mom come see you?
On the weekends, once, like either Saturday or Sunday.
I don't know how the loneliness doesn't take over.
You can't let it.
How do you stay positive, though, in such a, it's such a negative situation? I mean, how does it get worse?
I actually have to keep, like I make myself little posters,
yeah.
You know, that I keep up so that when I'm in my room, I can look up and, you know, I'll have stuff on there like, beautiful living is wisdom, you know, or perfect love, perfect trust, things like that, just to keep my mind right, because the atmosphere, it's heavy.
Do you get a chance to speak to a psychotherapist, or do you get to speak to anybody about your feelings?
The problem with that is if you try to talk to somebody here like that, then they're quick to put you on medication. They're quick to throw you on an antidepressant or anything because it's easier that way.
Do you have an appeal in the pipeline at the moment?
There's different phases, but you're automatically under an appeal.
And how often can you appeal?
You actually only have one appeal, and then everything after that is a challenge to the response to that first appeal.
Okay. The man that was involved in the crime with you, I noticed that he got a life sentence and you got death. Why do you think that was?
He went after me, and the jury chose to give him life. Ooh, behind a door?
Pardon?
I wouldn't wish behind a door for anybody.
You wouldn't even wish that for him, even though you've spent 5-6 years behind a door and he has been living life in prison just as a life prisoner.
I don't wish death row on anybody. That is not okay.
No.
Nobody has a right to do that to anybody.
And how long do you think that you'll actually be here for?
I honestly don't know. And I think in a way, it's just excited expectation, you know? Sometimes it's better not to exactly know, because then you get your hopes up, and then if something doesn't go the way you want it to, then, you know, you're brought back down. But I have children, I have to stay positive, I have to fight.
Yeah, you do have 2 kids on the outside world.
Four.
Four children, do you? And do you know where they are now or anything?
Yes, they're all with family, but they're separated.
And so what age were they when you were taken to prison?
My oldest son was 7 and my oldest daughter was 5. Caleb was 2 and I was pregnant.
Oh, and you were pregnant when you came in. And how long did you get to keep the baby for?
I got to hold her for 15 minutes twice the day I had her.
And that was it?
That was it. Haven't seen her since.
That must be super hard. Do you think that's the hardest part about being in here?
Yeah, that is the hardest part.
The woman that was murdered, she had a family, and the family are probably quite happy that you did get the death penalty. Can you understand where they're coming from?
I can and I can't. Because they wanted it for me, but not for my co-defendant.
Oh, they didn't want it for
him? I remember you asked me something in one of your letters about women. And why do I feel like they are so much harder on women?
Yeah.
I believe that in this country, women are still fighting for equal standing with men.
Do you think that the courts are tougher on women?
Mm. Men can commit crimes, men can do, and it'll be in the media and it'll die down so quick. But yeah. Let a woman do it, and it carries on, and it carries on. I mean, and it's just, I don't understand that.
Why do you think there was such interest in yours then with you?
I was pregnant. I was young. It was big for this place. I don't know.
So if you had better relationships, you probably wouldn't find yourself in the position you're in now.
I wouldn't have found myself in a lot of situations I was in when I was young.
Do you think that a lot of people in here, they just don't have a great start on life? I mean, if you were given better opportunities, grew up in a better environment, would you still have found yourself here?
I would say that my childhood had a lot to do with bad relationships and bad choices regarding men growing up, not knowing my own worth, not knowing my value, and not recognizing a healthy from an unhealthy relationship.
You just got yourself involved then with this one relationship, and that's sort of what turned your whole life around. With that guy, if you had never met him, do you think that your life would be on a totally different path?
Yeah, but I mean, like, I look at all of this and,
yeah.
You know, a lot of people ask me, how am I not bitter, you know, when I maintain my innocence and I'm still sitting here? And I look at it this way, since being here, I actually have found myself. I've learned to love myself. I realized that I don't have to, you know, because I didn't know how to love men. I never knew how, because of everything I knew growing up, it was always like an emotional shutoff. Like I didn't know how to love them, and I wouldn't let them love me, and I'd push them away, and I would sabotage my relationships because I never wanted a man to get too close, because if he got too close, he could hurt me. So coming here and actually being taken away from all of that has actually helped me grow up and become a better person, period. Better for my children, better for myself, better for my family, because now I can make better, healthier, right decisions because I know who I am.
Less than 2 days after I met Emilia, mother of three, Kelly Gisson Danner, was executed by lethal injection in Georgia, having spent 18 years on death row. Like Emilia, she'd used her time on death row to study. The news hit me hard. I'd expected to meet a much tougher woman than the dark-eyed girl I met in that orange prison jumpsuit in Ocala, Florida. And no matter what terrible things she might have done, I do think it's an inhumane society that would seek to take her life.